Rabbit Babbit. This is a review discussion of David Hume in the context of Kant's prolegomena to any metaphysics, any future metaphysics that might be able to come forth as a science. And so one of the things we're going to be looking at in this review will be reading Hume to the extent that, as Kant says, he awakens Kant from his dogmatic slumber. So I'm going to share a screen and we'll go over some of the slides that we saw in class and some that we did not, in order to frame the reading of Kant for the final exam. But also there'll be a little review that I hope to be able to post on the prolegomena just for a refresher. And we're going to have a refresher in just the same sense for David Hume just now. So as you see, just a refresher. And what's meant by that, of course, is a look back at, this is the Dover edition of David Hume's A Treatise of Human Nature. To a certain extent, different readings, those people who are worried about different editions, it's only really a matter of being able to keep up with page assignments, because David Hume wrote in English, so we don't really have differences between renderings, although sometimes David Hume's Scottish English is modified, that is to say, from the 18th to the 20th or 21st century sensibility, that can introduce problems, and sometimes it's clarifying, sometimes not. But we're just going to be going back over this again. Now, you have here a kind of representation and how one would be able to understand this in the German, but you also have that beautifully contextualized. What is Hume in German? Because, and if you will have taken a look at the introduction in Hatfield to the Prolegomena, this is something that's thematized. So although there's a dispute, and although Hatfield comes down on one side rather than another, technically speaking, Kant could have read either the treatise or the Enquiry, to the extent that all of David Hume's writings had been translated into German as of 1760. So Manfred Kuhn, who is himself a Kant scholar and a Hume scholar, tells us that between 1739 and 1800, Hume is really hot stuff in German, as the Göttingische Anzeigung von Gelehrten Sachen, beautifully named, so it's a newsletter of scholarly things, published some 60 reviews and discussions dedicated to David Hume, including renderings, that is to say, including things that count as translations. And here we have the Enquiry with, of course, the ubiquitous billiards table. The treatise itself, which is what we took a look at, exists in several different, this is the very expensive and very large Norton, David Fate Norton and Mary J. Norton treatise. This is the second volume, but of course there are two. And in book one of the understanding, this is fundamentally what we took a look at, going all the way up to a knowledge and probability. So the origin of our ideas, and that's a good way to review in any case, always look at the table of contents, division the subject of the ideas of the memory and imagination, of the connection, little X right there, or association, good way to understand that, of ideas, of relations, where it becomes a little more elusive, of modes and substances, of abstract ideas, and then part two, of the ideas of space and time. And now that we've read Kant, that's a little clearer. I think it should be at this point, because here the infinite divisibility of the ideas of space and time, and then the other qualities of those same ideas, objections answered, and so on. And then where it begins to become significant for Kant, of knowledge of probability and of the idea of cause and effect, why one is always necessary, and then of course why induction is not going to be the way. So you see, the connection association of ideas is already that concern, and that's of course the reason for introducing that little arrow, and you can see right down there why cause is always necessary. For quick statement, We have from section 2 of the understanding the claims that are made seriatim. The cause and effect must be contiguous in space and time. The cause, to be a cause, must be prior to the effect. It has to come before, antecedent to the effect. There has to be, David Hume says, a constant union betwixt cause and effect, because otherwise, why would one describe it as a cause and effect? And he says it's chiefly this quality that constitutes the relation. The same cause always produces the same effect, or you're really not going to be able to speak of causation. And notice what he's looking for. And the same effect as effect never arises but from the same cause. And then lastly, where several different objects produce the same effect, it must be by means of some quality which we discover to be common amongst them. There's got to be something that is cause as such, or causation. Now, the way he begins stays with us, and for the most part, it is significant. Hume's clear, all perceptions of the human mind fall into two distinct kinds, and they're related. And the way that they're related is that impressions are going to be more forceful, greater vivacity, and ideas, which of course are going to be derived from these. So they only differ in the degrees of force and liveliness, so one stronger than the other, but really they are then on the same continuum, same empiricist continuum, as some will say. And this is David Hume's answer to Descartes. So obviously David Hume is not arguing in the same way that Descartes does, when Descartes suggests that although you have this idea of God and you have to have some origin for that, that is greater than that idea, Hume thinks you can get there by degrees. So, as he says, every idea, all ideas, copied from a similar impression. So just as Descartes distinguishes between the ideas that he has, some, just a quick sneaking in a bit of a reminder of Descartes right here, Descartes clarifies that there are ideas that are already in him. This is the most famous of the Cartesian ideas, the innate kind, and those things correspond to things that are going to be given to him by the light of nature, where he will see things like the relationship between cause and effect, and adventitious, or ideas that one encounters in the world outside, something that you do very much the source of the impressions, as Hume will speak of them, and ideas that are cobbled together, self-made, factitious sometimes that's called. And Hume makes a similar classification, but he says that of all of the ideas, they're all of them going to be copied from a similar impression, where Descartes had three basic sort of sorts of ideas. For David Hume, all ideas are going to be copied from, derived from, a relation, sort of resemblance of a similarity between impression, which is stronger or more forceful, and the idea. Now, that means that the idea of God, meaning, and he gives the same definition instructively as Descartes gives, an infinitely intelligent, wise, and good being, arises from reflecting on the operations of our own mind. Why? Because one is thinking of the intelligent, the wise, and the good. And we have those things in us, have those in one way or another, and one then just augments them without limit. Those qualities, sorry, that's two repetitions of goodness and wisdom. Secondly, this is another, because this will be the question of how impressions will then be able to lead to or generate or produce an idea. If it happened from the defect of the organ, that a man is not susceptible of any species of sensation, we always find that he is as little susceptible of the correspondent ideas. So a blind man can form no notion of colors, a deaf man no notion of sounds. And that claim then really should clarify the way Hume sees ideas in association, because they're going to be associated in basically three ways. They're going to look one like the other. The resemblance will be the case. This looks like this. Contiguity, this always is associated or comes in connection alongside this. And then what is really the one which is for him important but most elusive, and that's cause and effect. One seems to be generated or caused by the other. The effect is caused by the cause, and that's how ideas will be associated. And if we look at part three, here in this particular case, and we're going to be moving between, because Kant can move between the enquiry and the treatise, there are seven different kinds of philosophical relations. So he classifies them in this way: resemblance, identity, relations of time and place, or you could say space, proportion in quantity or number, degrees in inequality, right? Remember the shades of blue, or as Kant will later speak of red with regard to cinnabar, contrariety, how things can be contrary one to another, and causation. Okay, so that I put in bold what's going to be most important, obviously, for you. And we have here what is probably essential. This is added, this is not in Hume himself, but this is the medieval square of oppositions as these are otherwise understood. A, E, I, and O being the forms. So every S is P is, of course, makes a statement that for every S, every subject, one will be able to say that it is or has the property or of which may be predicated as such a quality P. And that claim, S is P, S being the subject, P being the predicate, is contrary to, you see, on the other side, no, the negation, S is P. There are subalterns, some S is P, or some S is not P, and obviously contraries and subcontraries, and all of these then are going to be contradictory one to the other. Every S is P, some S is not P is all you need for every S is P not to be true, and likewise contradictory, no S is P, the only thing you need is for some to be, for that to be contradicted. Now, well, the reason this is significant is because Hume is arguing logically, and he's looking for a logical connection because only that is necessary. Everything else is contingent if it's merely empirical. So all humans are rational. The contrary would be to say, no, no, right? And that's obviously what we wouldn't want to say. And of course, but notice, if we can even find one not quite rational human being, we're not able to say all human beings are. And of course, that's the logical square, as I have explained this, of opposition, because in people these days will use Venn diagrams. If you take a course in logic, you will sometimes see this, and you can add your own text right there if you want. The relations may be divided into two classes, Hume goes on to say, into such as depend entirely on the ideas which we compare together, and such as may be changed without any change in the ideas. So the ideas are going to be significant, but with regard to causation, beyond the constant conjunction of similar objects and the consequent inference from the one to the other, we have no notion of necessity. So constant conjunction really refers to habit, and he's suggesting that that's really all you're getting. This has always accompanied this, and this has always been followed by that. It has always been constantly conjoined, and therefore we tend, once we see the one, to assume the other. But what we lack is any notion of necessity or connection. And that's important. He's not saying that you don't have constant conjunctions. He's not saying that this doesn't always come, the one followed then by the other. That is the habit, that is the experience. What he is observing or pointing out is that we lack necessity. So the connection in its deepest way isn't there. All we have is the association of constantly conjoined association. And we have the expectation, the inference from one to the other. So when we look at section two of probability and the idea of cause and effect, where we're moving a little bit further ahead, there's a resuming review in David Hume's own words, where he explains that all kinds of reasoning will be consist of nothing but a comparison and a discovery of those relations, either constant or inconstant, which two or more objects bear to each other. And this can also help us understand what Kant is doing in his categories or in his table of judgments. So this comparison we make either when both the objects are present to the senses, or when neither of them is present, or when only one. So if one is present, but you, when you are presented with or tend to expect the other to follow, you're going to have that relationship. And there it gives us that wonderful idea of domino effects. And you can, if you had the domino effect, and if this were a gift, you'd be able to see that. So he continues to say, it appears that out of the three relations which we've just gone through, which depend not on the mere ideas, the only one that can be traced beyond our senses and informs us of existences and objects which we don't see or feel, because it's not presented to us, is going to be causation. Because causation, if we perceive or claim causation, tells us that when we're presented with a particular event, that it is either being caused by some event we don't see, or that it itself as a cause might effect an effect we do not yet see. So his problem here is, let's explain that. Because how can you have this wonderful property of, as it were, being able to predict the future? How can you have this probability, in fact, of being able to see into the past, make you an excellent detective, and know what the actual cause of anything was? Know, as it were, without even a smoking gun, what the source of a particular event might have been. So he says, we're going to consider the idea of causation. What is it? Question what its source is going to be. So that's similar to the kind of argument that Descartes would have. It's very logical and points out that it's impossible to reason justly without understanding perfectly the idea concerning which we reason. And he says, it's impossible perfectly to understand any idea without tracing it up to its origin, which means, because that's going to be the strongest thing, examining that primary impression from which it arises. Where do we get the idea of cause? And cause being a very specific thing, just as Descartes could define God very specifically, Hume defines cause with the same degree of specificity. So, as he says, the idea has to be derived, based on what he's previously said, this can't be any exception, from some relation among objects. And that's what he now tries to discover and finds in the first place, that whatever objects are considered as causes or effects are contiguous. Right? They've got to connect. There's got to be contact. And nothing can operate in a time or place which is ever so little removed from those of its existence. So there has to be contact, and it's got to be evidently connected. Thus, this eliminates a very spooky thing, action at a distance. Although distant objects may sometimes seem productive of each other, they're commonly found upon examination to be linked by a chain of causes. So there are going to be a continuum, or Kant will speak of the manifold of space, which are contiguous among themselves and to the distant objects. And when in any particular instance we cannot discover this connection, we still presume it to exist, and we undertake scientific investigations until we find it. Therefore, this is the key for you. We consider the relation of contiguity, being connected side by side, one to another, as essential to that of causation, and may suppose it such according to the general opinion, at least until we find a more proper occasion to clear up the matter by examining what objects are or are not susceptible of juxtaposition and of connection, or in this contiguous sense. So he continues to say, shall we rest contented with these two relations of contiguity and succession as affording a complete idea? Will that do? And he answers his own question, by no means. So for him, it's not going to be sufficient. Why? Because, in fact, all the time, you can have objects that are contiguous and objects that happen in advance of a particular event without being considered, in fact, its cause. They can just be any accidental happenstance. So you have a problem. Because what we mean when we say cause is that it's caused, very, very straightforwardly. There's a necessary connection to be taken into consideration. The necessary connection is going to be of much greater importance than any of the other two that's already mentioned, etc. Again, look at the object. That's what he does. He says, I'm looking at the nature of the necessary connection. and I find the impression or impressions from which the idea is derived, when I cast my eye on the known qualities of objects, I immediately discover that the relation of cause and effect depends not in the least on them. So there's trouble. All I get, and this is his conclusion, looking at their relations, I find none but contiguity and succession, only that, and therefore no necessary connection, and that's a problem. So he thinks perhaps one should despair of success, and indeed he should, because first, he asks, this is a question, for what reason? We pronounce it necessary that everything whose existence has a beginning should also have a cause. How do we know? What's our reason for making that claim? Where do we get there? And secondly, why, there's again a further question, why we conclude that such particular causes must necessarily have such particular effects, and what is the nature of that inference we draw from the one to the other and of the belief we repose in it? Now, we pointed to on the table of contents that section 3, why a cause is always necessary. It behooves us to take a look at that. His answer is already clear. For David Hume, what's at issue is constant conjunction. Thus, in advancing, he says, we have insensibly discovered a new relation betwixt cause and effect when we least expected it, and were entirely employed on another subject looking for this necessity. But what we have found is their constant conjunction. They're constantly conjoined. It always happens thus. And I can't help it, but that's what we're talking about. We're talking about the always meaning, and this will be essential when we look at Kantian apodicticity, that it cannot not be. And that's a grand claim. It's a very, very large claim. J.K. Rowling made it the basis of her entire Harry Potter sequels. But the contiguity and succession, now, if those were the three relationships where you'd be looking for this idea of necessity, contiguity and succession, not sufficient. It's not enough that they come always one alongside the other, or that one succeeds or follows the other. We're not going to have a basis on this means, contiguity and succession, for pronouncing any two objects as to be cause and effect. They may be incidental. Unless, and that's what we're going to need in addition, we perceive that these two relations are preserved in several instances. We're going to need constant conjoining. In fact, we're going to need always. The only connection or relation of objects which can lead us beyond the immediate impressions, we already saw that, of memory and senses, is that of cause and effect, and that because it's the only one on which we can found a just inference from one object to another. Now, the logical relationship that he's looking for is entailment, material implication. If A, then B, which is, of course, what we mean by saying that A is the cause of B, such that, since I have that as in a causal connection, if A, then B, where the claim is that A entails B, then if I am presented with A, I'm logically justified in concluding and thus expecting, therefore, B. So the inference that I'm looking for example, we can say if there's rain, drops and so on and so forth, then B, it's going to be the kind of inclement weather which will require you to bring along an umbrella. That can be concluded or inferred. And the idea of cause and effect is derived. This is Hume's contention from experience. And what does experience tell us empirically? That such particular objects in all past instances have been constantly conjoined with each other. It's always happened in that way. And as an object similar to one of these is supposed to be immediately present in its impression, we thence presume on the existence of one similar to its usual attendant. So if we've always had the one with a particular accompanied consequence or succession, we, programmed in this way, presented with the one tend to expect the other. According to this, though, and he thinks it's in every point unquestionable, he's not challenging it, probability is founded on the presumption of a resemblance betwixt those objects of which we've had experience and those of which we've had none, and therefore it's impossible that this presumption can arise from probability. So you would expect him to conclude, well, then it's really going to be a matter of inductive generalization. Precisely that's what he refuses, because what you are needing to do is to go beyond your experience, almost sort of the a priori language that Kant is going to be using. And in fact, David Hume uses that same language of a priori. Here he clarifies it. The same principle cannot be both the cause and effect of another, and this is perhaps the only proposition concerning that relation which is intuitively or demonstratively certain, but it doesn't tell us where we're getting cause and effect from. It just tells us you can't have one and the same, question of identity. Therefore, he says, it shall be allowed that the production of one object by another in any one instance implies a power. So we're looking for the same thing Descartes was looking for, the power of bringing about, generating an effect as cause. But the problem is, having already proved that the power lies not in the sensible qualities of the cause, and there being nothing but those sensible qualities, the problem is, as he says, and this is why he asks, why, in other instances, you presume that the same power still exists merely upon the appearance of these qualities. The appeal that we make, it always happened thus. It happened this way yesterday, sun rose, and so on and so forth. Your appeal to past experience decides nothing in the present case, and at the utmost can only prove that that very object which produced any other was at that very instant endowed with such a power, but doesn't necessarily tell you that it always would be. And lacking that always would be, you don't have causation. That's the problem. So past experience just tells you what happened in the past. It does not tell you that it has to happen in that way. It does not tell you that it must happen in the same way. So what you don't have is necessity. Missing necessity, you are missing causation. That's the point of the sentence as it continues. It can never prove that the same power must continue in the same object or collection of sensible qualities, much less that a like power is always conjoined with like sensible qualities. Should it be said that we have experience, that the same power continues with the same object, and that like objects are endowed with like powers. Now, what he's talking about are empirical properties, and he's suggesting that the fact that something has had a particular set of empirical properties in the past doesn't justify you in concluding that another object, not the same, but another object, but similar to that same object, will also have, because of its similarity, the same properties. And that's what he thinks you're lacking. You don't have the justification for it. And in fact, you could be quite prejudiced and you could be quite wrong. So you want to be careful in making those assumptions. To that extent, he says, not only our reason fails us in the discovery of the ultimate connection of causes and effects, but even after experience has informed us of the constant conjunction, it is impossible for us to satisfy ourselves by our reason. Now, our habit is satisfied, our expectation, our prejudices are satisfied, but our reason, that's not so easily extended, because here we would need to be able to say that experience can be extended beyond those particular instances which have fallen under our observation to things we've never seen. And that's a problem. For that, you need to be a kind of mystic who can predict the future. But that's what we do. We predict the future when we say that something is the cause of something else. Because if we say that A is the cause of B, the effect, then what we are saying is that presented with A, we can with certainty wait for it to expect B as the result, as the effect. Because what we're saying is that A is able to generate, just in the same way Descartes argued, to bring about, and therefore to be at least equal to and greater than B, it's consequent or effect. That's what Hume is questioning. Now, questioning cause and effect brings Hume to clarify the point one more time. He does this several times when you're doing the reading. He says, we suppose, but are never able to prove, that there must be a resemblance betwixt those objects of which we've had experience and those which lie beyond the reach of our discovery, because they're in the future, perhaps. And so we take that for granted. We are inclined to draw this conclusion. We're set up to think that there's such a thing as causation, and we're set up to think that there's such a thing as an effect brought about by the cause, but that's a supposition, not, as he says, a certainty or a necessity. One more time. We've not got anything else. All we have, when it comes to cause and effect, is a notion of certain objects which have been always conjoined together, and which in all past instances have been found inseparable. The problem for you is that we lack the reason, the logic of it, the necessary account which would say that it cannot not be, which of course is what for Hume is what we're talking about when we say that something causes or brings about something else as effect. So he's taking the word cause very, very rigorously, and he's taking the word effect very, very rigorously. He's not simply talking about antecedent and consequent. That could be accidental, as we've already stressed. So, and we're almost in Kantian terms here. We only observe the thing itself. Notice this is not the thing in itself, but just the thing. And always find that from the constant conjunction, the objects acquire a union and union. This is our Scots English in the imagination. When the impression of one becomes present to us, we immediately form an idea. We have an expectation of its usual attendant. And consequently, we may establish this as one part of the definition of an opinion or belief, that it's an idea related to or associated with the present impression. Thus, the next section continues, although causation be a philosophical relation, one we've already seen in Descartes and one that we're going to be talking about with regard to Kant, implying contiguity, succession, and constant conjunction, yet it is only so far as it's a natural relation and produces a union among our ideas that we're able to reason upon it or draw any inference from it. So it's natural. We assume it naturally, but that doesn't mean logically. And logically is the problem, of course, if what we're interested in is science. So, quick, his own reflection now. This is Hume. I have found, he's no denying it, that such an object has always been attended with such an effect. And I foresee that other objects which are in appearance similar will be attended with similar effects. There are billiard balls once again. One is always experienced after impact going to have an equal and opposite reaction. I shall allow, continues to say, if you please, that the one proposition may justly be inferred from the other. I know, in fact, that it always is inferred. Folks do infer it. But if you insist that the inference, if A then B, is made by a chain of reasoning like that material entailment, if A then B, A therefore B, give me the reasoning. That's what he asks. I desire you to produce that reasoning. Where's the logic? That's really what he's asking. So the transitive property that we're looking for, known as the law of syllogism, is really what he's pointing to. If A then B, and if B then if A then C, same thing. So in logic, once again, the implication, A implies B and B implies C, then A implies C. So, for example, there's an easy one. If the electric power is cut, then the refrigerator doesn't work. If the refrigerator doesn't work, then the food is spoiled. So cut the electric power and you can pretty well expect that the food will go bad in the refrigerator. For Hume, and this is where we had some trouble in class because it's a challenging concept. He says that the sun will not rise tomorrow is no less intelligible a proposition and implies no more contradiction than the affirmation that it will rise. So you can say that it will not rise with the same clarity that you could say, and with no contradiction at all, to make the opposite claim that it will rise, that it will not rise, that it will rise, that it will not rise, meaning that we should in vain attempt to demonstrate its falsehood. Were it demonstratively false, it would imply a contradiction and could never be distinctly conceived by the mind. So we're not able to conceive, in the case of a demonstrable, rational, logical falsehood, we're not able to articulate that because we unsay it in saying it. But in fact, we're able to say, without contradiction, the sun will not rise tomorrow. We hope it will, but saying the sun will not rise tomorrow implies no necessary connection. So, for example, in the Old Testament, when it is suggested that the sun does stand still for the course of a day and doesn't, in fact, set, there's no, it's a miracle, you could say, but it doesn't necessarily offend our logical sensibilities. We're able to imagine that something could happen. And now that we know more about astronomy, we could think that perhaps a very, very large comet could pass by in such a way, since it is the Earth that is turning and the sun not really doing anything in terms of rising, but they could perturb that turning in such a way that it would appear that the sun stood still of a day. That's entirely possible. So it's not demonstratively false. It's in fact utterly thinkable. We can imagine it. So, human causality, not in any instance attained by reasonings a priori, that's the language that Hume uses, it's not prior to experience, but arises entirely from experience. But if it arises from experience entirely, it's contingent, it's a matter of fact, it's not necessary. But that means it's not very much cause, it's not causation per se, it's just association. So the synthesis, the effect, this is the implication here, is totally different from the cause and consequently can never be discovered in it. So they are two distinct things, and the one might happen otherwise differently than it always has. You can always get a different result. It's empirical. The problem then lies there. Post hoc. Ergo propter hoc, and the Latin is after this or following from this, therefore, because of this, and that's a fallacy. That's a fallacy. The fact that something follows something doesn't necessarily mean, as it comes afterwards or follows upon it, that it is therefore caused by it. That's what he says. Resemblance is the most fertile source of error. It's the basis of prejudice. And he says, there are few mistakes in reasoning which do not borrow largely from that origin. But that doesn't mean you should think that way and you should be open to other possibilities. Okay, so that's a quick review of what's going on, and we'll look at a review of the Prolegomena and Immanuel Kant's resolution. Thanks for your attention.